What people have found is that if you show people deepfake videos, for example, they can misremember things in the past. So you can get them to believe something happened and they'll say, oh yeah, I think, isn't that what happened? Because they've seen a deep fake on it. I'm Dr. Matthew Aylett. I'm an engineer and a researcher, and I've been working for some years in areas like deep fakes. With deep fakes, what people are doing is they're using computers to model the image of someone or the voice of someone, which means you can then use the computer to generate new data. So you can make the voice say something different or something which never said before, or you can take someone's face and you can change what they've said or what they're looking at or where they are in the scene. Misinformation in general is always a problem, because there are a lot of people who want people to believe things which aren't true because it's suits their agenda.
I think we saw a few uses of deepfakes during the Ukraine war. I mean, I hope most of them were harmless, most of them were just jokes. But there was two fake surrender videos going around, one of Putin and one of Zelensky. And those are very harmful misinformation videos.
When there's been deepfakes being produced by quite big organizations like as propaganda for governments and different countries, or large organizations of digital experts who put together deepfakes specifically in order to, you know, maybe present something in a way which is not true.
I'm actually working on a paper right now, and so the rapper Kendrick Lamar recently released a music video called The Hard Part 5, and it showed him rapping and then have multiple different deepfakes of people like Kanye West, Kobe Bryant, and different like famous people as well. It's being used more and more in media and entertainment, as well as, you know, as forms of misinformation.
So there's lots of room for using deepfake technology within the media and within arts to do things which have an impact, which are good. But of course, it also can be used in other ways. And this is the same with photography, with writing, with print, with all types of media. It depends really what the agenda is of the person that is using that technology.
I suppose there's a few telltale signs. I think it usually involves the kind of blurring of the face. I think objects passing in and out of around the face. If someone puts on their glasses, they look very, very awful. I think at the moment, there's not too much of a worry about the quality. I think most of it's very noticeable, unless you're watching very low quality content on, let's say, Twitter. If it's very compressed, it can be harder to tell then.
Most deep fakes that you'll see are not that great. And that's partly because they've been put together by amateurs. Also because it's actually still quite hard to build those models of people without them giving you lots of data, for example, lots of pictures of themselves, lots of audio of themselves speaking. That's why they can be so good in films, because the actors allowed themselves to be made into those models. But it is improving all the time. And in fact, in some situations, like for example, having a talking head speaking directly to camera, that is actually quite easy to do now and can look quite convincing.
I definitely think there's two improvements which are happening. I think one is becoming more accessible and the other is becoming more realistic. And both of those have equal harms for misinformation.
It's always important to factor in the human element behind it, right? Because like deepfakes are the way they are because of the people behind them that use them for like malicious purposes, or as some of my research is kind of like hoping to like find out now, the more positive aspects of deepfakes as well.
I suppose the best thing that I've learned from deepfakes, just kind of how AI is changing our lives and how it is, even in many positive ways, changing our lives. And it's going to assist us in a lot of ways. And it also might harm us in some ways, like deepfakes shows us. But I think the positive person in me likes to believe that the good outweighs the bad.
Like, we're always worried about like, oh, AI taking over the world, or like, you know, deepfakes being something like really like malicious and stuff. And while it can have these uses, it's important to understand the human motivation behind it.
I think there's a real important need for a healthy skepticism. I think what people have to realize is that although these things can happen, that they're not always happening. So you shouldn't take every video you see and start calling them a deepfake.
I think in a way, I mean, it's the same old story. It's the same if someone sends you, you know, a post on Facebook that says X, Y, Z. Is it true? Do you believe the person that sent it to you? What is the source? Is there anyone else that says that sort of thing? So in a way, the first thing is just to be skeptical about what people tell you.